Welcome. In this video, I'm going to hit a few topics relating to inflation layers. I hope to provide you with some background knowledge, as well as build intuition through practical application on a boundary layer case in OpenFOAM. As always, the case files are in the GitHub repo linked below. A quick note that I've cleaned up my profile and fixed all of the links on my videos, so let me know if you see any issues. Also, please like, subscribe, and share my content. If you like what I'm doing, please consider supporting me on Patreon too. Alright, without further ado, let's get started. Please note that the following information is only applicable to RAND-style CFD calculations, and not others such as large eddy simulations. In the following video, I will be mainly focusing also on the mesh generation and the theory behind inflation layers. As such, there's not much information on how to actually run the simulation. If you would like more information on this, I would recommend one of my previous videos, likely my first video on the complete OpenFOAM LES tutorial. Before we create the mesh, let's go through some theory on why inflation layers are important. This will be useful in informing how we create the mesh. The two fundamental questions I will be addressing are as follows. 1. Why is it important to have finer cells near the wall? And 2. Why are the cells long and thin? The answer to both questions has to do with gradients. Specifically, we will be looking at velocity gradients and how the resolution of gradients depends on the mesh resolution. Note, a gradient for the purposes of this video is a change in the magnitude of a property with respect to a certain direction. A useful analogy is to think of mesh cells as locations where you are making a measurement and the gradient as changes in elevation. Imagine you are walking the following mountain and want to get an accurate topographic map, but you can only make 6 measurements. If you were clever, you would likely measure at the following locations, the peaks and the troughs. If you were just using uniform spacing, you'd probably get an elevation map that looks like this, which is much less accurate. Now imagine we're given a few more points. Where would we put them? Probably right around here. I think that this is very intuitive, but what are we doing mathematically? We are effectively placing points in areas where the landscape is changing most rapidly, or areas with high gradients. This is because of the linear interpolation we are doing between points. Likewise, in CFD we are performing linear interpolation between cells, so we want to place cells in the locations where the flow is changing most rapidly. In the case of boundary layer flow, the velocity is changing very rapidly normal to the wall due to the imposed no slip condition, but it is changing relatively slowly parallel to the wall. You can see on the figure to the right how the velocity profile is much closer to expected results when we have those thin cells near the wall. These are the equations used for calculating the parameters used to specify inflation layers, namely the first layer height, number of layers, and growth ratio. I took these from a video by Dr. Wimshurst, which is linked here. I will also link to it below. If you're interested in learning more, I highly recommend this video. It is long but extremely clear and worth watching. As a matter of fact, I watched it twice. Here's a Python code I created from the equations I just showed. It will be linked in the GitHub repo along with everything else. The values are hard-coded in so that you realize that you should modify this code for your specific problem. The biggest thing to modify is probably the boundary layer height. As you can see, for my problem, the suggested first layer height is around 4 mil. Because I'm doing this with blockMesh, I'm just going to use this handy tool to generate the specifications for my mesh. If you're using another tool, you can easily input the results from the code directly into the inputs of your meshing software. And this is the mesh setup I will be using. As you can see, it is a 2D mesh with 7,500 cells. You can see that the entire mesh is basically inflation layers. This is a bit overkill, but works out nicely for this simulation. Now I'll show you the boundary conditions I used and how I calculated them. The first is a turbulent inlet, an outlet, a no-slip wall. This is where we will see the boundary layer. A couple empty planes because the simulation is 2D, and a slip wall at the top. As I have shown before, I just used the following online calculator to calculate my turbulent inlet properties. I used a length scale of 1 here, but it probably should have been 3. And here are the properties in my 0 folder. I think they are pretty self-explanatory. A couple notes I will make are that I used a kOmega turbulence model because I was interested mainly in the near wall phenomena. Also note that for the velocity condition on the plate, I impose a fixed velocity of 0 instead of saying no slip. I don't know why, but this always seems to work better for me. Sometimes I see slipping with the no slip condition, even when I make sure that my layers and everything else is properly set up. If you know why, please leave it in the comments. Then I just ran the simulation as usual. The instructions will be provided in the repo, along with everything else if you need them. I ran this as a transient solution, just so you can see how the flow developed. If you are interested in just computing forces, you can easily modify it to run steady state using SimpleFoam. And finally, you can see that the yplus in the first cell is right around 1. You may need to run a mesh refinement study if you are looking to use the results for something. The outline I provided here is just to make a good first guess. As always, thanks for watching. There is plenty more coming in the near future.